So, as the Linux Policy Administration, the basics. We're going to try to explain how you can make the case for SE Linux. So, the first thing we're going to discuss is the inevitability of failure, the flawed assumption of security in modern computer systems. Now, this is a title of a paper that was published by the National Security Agency. So it's, you can Google it. So let's just try and Google that. And here it is, but it's not the... authoritative side. So, and there's no date as to when it was published, but suffice to say that this paper was published right before SE Linux was submitted for inclusion in the Linux kernel. And the takeaway of it is that there's this flawed assumption of security in modern computer environments. And that was, you need to keep in mind that that was right before the SE Linux security framework was submitted for inclusion in the Linux kernel. So it's basically the part of the case for SE Linux, or at least the case for secure operating systems, and I made that one point. We need secure operating systems. That's basically the case that this paper makes, and you are encouraged to read it. What it says is that, or the takeaway I have from it is that it says man is flawed, humans are always bound to make mistakes, and since operating over computer systems, processes in computer systems are really created by humans, programs, user agents, basically are coded by humans, so they are bound to have flaws as well, and humans make mistakes, so humans are also flawed. So a way to deal with that is a secure operating system. If you can basically contain man on a different level, on a lower or on a higher level, it depends on how you look at it, on the level above man, so to speak. And that means mandatory access control on a operating system level, basically. So flexible mandatory access control that complements identity based discretionary access control. So identity based discretionary access control is the traditional Linux security model, and it basically assigns user identity identifiers and group identity identifiers to subjects and objects in the system, and it basically assigns permission bits to subjects and objects in the system, a combination of permission bits and user ID and group ID identifiers. And basically you create a group and user identifier by using the user add command, and the system will associate those identifiers to objects and subjects created by that user ID or group ID identifier. And then basically it also assigns the permission bits, and that's basically how identity-based discretionary access control works. And flexible mandatory access controls, SE Linux, complements that traditional Linux security model. So SE Linux sits below traditional Linux security, and that's important to understand. So it's basically you can look at it as two layers. On top of the stack, you have traditional Linux security, and below on the stack, you have the flexible mandatory access control implemented by SE Linux. So SE Linux aims to do a couple things to achieve secure operating systems. Basically, it's the main goal is to enforce integrity. So let's look at enforcing integrity from both the perspective of traditional Linux security, the identity-based discretionary access control, and the mandatory, the flexible mandatory access control implemented by SE Linux, and see how the traditional Linux security falls short and where SE Linux tries to fill in the gaps. So one property, the main property of identity-based discretionary access control, is that it's discretionary. So that means that, as said, the user identity and the group identity are assigned to subjects and objects in a system, and permission bits are additionally associated to subjects and objects in the system, and then the user identity is allowed to govern the permission bits. And so we know the permission bits are user read, write, execute, group read, write, execute, and others read, write, execute. So a user identity assigned to a subject or object is able to allow others to read, write, and execute subjects or objects by basically governing the permission bits. So that's to the discretion of the user identity, and that's considered decentralized because you can have many user identities on the system, and they all create processes and subjects and objects, processes and files, so to speak. And so all these different identities can govern the security aspects over the subjects and objects they create. So that's decentralized security. It's not governed from a centralized place. And it's discretionary. These user identities can basically each decide for themselves how others can access those processes and files. So that's an issue, because we earlier discussed that man is flawed, and man is basically associated to these user identity and group identity identifiers. So basically, you're saying with discretionary access control or identity-based discretionary access control that we trust man to govern security over subjects and objects that man creates. Now that's a problem, because man is flawed, so man is bound to make mistakes with regard to governing the permission bits, the security of objects and subjects that man creates. So that's a problem there. So mandatory access control basically aims to bridge that gap or neutralize that threat by implementing a mandatory access control model. And that basically means two things. It means that the security policy is governed centralized and is mandatory to user identities on the system. So partly mandatory access control can override discretionary access control, but partly not. So let's explain that briefly. So for example, if a user identity on the system created a object, a file, and he decided to let the world or let others read that file, then one could override that on a system operating system level using centralized security policy to disallow that on a system-wide level anyways. But that doesn't work the other way around. So if a user identity basically denies others to read a file created by a user identity on in a system, then the the mandatory access control layer, the Azure Linux layer in the stack, cannot override that by saying no, we want to allow that anyway on a operating system level. So that's why I'm saying it's partly able to override but not fully. So that's basically a model to deal with the problem that man is flawed. We don't want user identities to have the ultimate saying over who is not allowed something to do something on the system, and then in this regard user identities creating objects and subjects. So that's one aspect of enforcing integrity, centralized governance of security rather than decentralized governance of security. The second aspect is that the traditional identity-based discretionary access control model employed by traditional Linux security is considered a coarse-grained access control. It's it provides access permissions to processes on the system. So a user identity creates objects and subjects in the system. Each of these objects and subjects get assigned the user identity and the group identity identifier and the permission bits. So they all have the same user identity identifier and group identity identifier, and the permission bits may differ. But the problem is that they all these processes on the system have the same user identity and group identity identifier. That means that each process can govern the permission bits of all the other processes owned by the or created by the same user identity on the system. So that basically means that one process can manipulate another process, or one process can manipulate another process's files, system objects. And that basically means that processes can escalate. So that's what we mean with access permissions. Processes have more permissions than they strictly need, because they can basically govern security over processes created by the and files created by the same user identity. And yeah, that is basically not good for integrity. So for example, if you have a web browser process that runs on behalf of you, runs with your user identity, then that web browser process would be able to govern security, or just basically have full access to other files, objects, and processes owned by or created by that same user identity. So for example, a secret file, your web browser would be able to read secret files, but also actually govern access to that secret file, because that secret file is owned by the same user identity. And so that's bad. So mandatory access control aims to implement a fine-grained access control model. Basically enforce least privilege as opposed to access permissions. So processes have only the permissions needed strictly to do their job. So also, again, look at this from a stack perspective. On top of the stack, you have the traditional Linux security, and below you have the Azure Linux flexible mandatory access control, which is centralized governance of security. So basically what it does is now we'll not get into the details, but basically Azure Linux, the integrity enforcement part allows you to restrict processes to strictly what they need. So although they run two different processes run with the same user identity, they might not be able to affect each other because they might not need to be able to affect each other. Or if they need to be able to affect each other, they might be allowed to do that. The point is that mandatory access control allows for fine-grained access control. So it allows you to specify exactly what a process needs to be able to do. So those are basically two main issues with traditional Linux security that Azure Linux tries to neutralize, so to speak, tries to negate. So, but there are other shortcomings of traditional Linux security. Traditional Linux security has no notion of other things you might want to achieve from a security perspective on a system. For example, traditional Linux security cannot enforce confidentiality on a system, operating system level, because that's what traditional Linux security is. So enforcing confidentiality means controlling the flow of information in shared computer systems. So there's no way to achieve that with traditional Linux security. And there are confidentiality access controls implemented in some programs. It could be implemented on the application layer, but that still doesn't deal with the fact that we need secure operating systems. We need that security on the operating system level rather than an application level. So we really need to be able to enforce confidentiality on an operating system level. And the same goes with the enforcement of compartmentalization, or basically the isolation of processes, or separation of processes that would otherwise have the same security properties. And those two challenges of enforcing confidentiality and enforcing compartmentalization are dealt with additional optional constraints. So it's optional to enforce confidentiality or compartmentalization, and there are that optional functionality is achieved using additional constraints. So it's basically additional, an add-on to the enforcement of integrity, so to speak. So that allows you to basically override the enforcement of integrity part in ways implemented by Azure Linux. We'll get into that later. I just want you to have the broad overview of it. So the main goal of Azure Linux is enforcing integrity by governing policy centralized, that is mandatory to subjects on the system, and by allowing for fine-grained mandatory access control that enables least privilege required by processes rather than the access permissions that processes have in a traditional Linux security environment. So that's the main takeaway of that. So what are the advantages of Azure Linux over traditional mandatory access control systems? What defines SE Linux compared to other mandatory access control systems? Well, SE Linux aims to be a flexible security framework. It means it's aims to be able to be applicable in most cases. It can be used for in environments where there are very many security requirements, where everything needs to be strict, but you can also use it in a system where you don't have such high requirements. And the part that enables that is that SE Linux provides many access factors. So access factors are means or ways to access something, and there are in SE Linux there are plenty ways to govern access to something. There are many access factors available, and we'll get into access factors later. Just remember the term access factors, because it's a access factors are basically the core security attributes of SE Linux. It's basically access factors are used to govern access. So yeah, that's basically SE Linux is flexible because it has so many access factors that. And it allows you to use all those access factors. You don't have to use them all to make your security policy super strict, but you can. So that's one aspect. So the other aspect that advantage of SE Linux over other mandatory access control systems is that SE Linux is configurable. And that's also a very important concept. So just like with traditional Linux security, where you assign user identities and group identity identifiers to subjects and objects in a system, and you can create those user identity identifiers and group identity identifiers by adding a user. You can call give that user a name, and that name is basically or a user identity number. And that is basically used to classify processes and files or subjects and objects created by that identifier. SE Linux enables us to classify subjects and objects using security identifiers. So SE Linux allows us to create strings and assign those strings to subjects and objects. And those strings can be used to identify particular processes and files in the system. So that's what makes it configurable. It allows us to basically declare those security identifiers and assign or associate those security identifiers to processes and files. And in theory, you can create as many security identifiers as you'd like, and you can assign them to any process or file in the system as an administrator, of course. So those are really two fundamental concepts, the concept of access factors and the concept of security identifiers. And so remember both terms. So identifying SE Linux, where is it? Well, is it, can you touch it, can you feel it? So SE Linux is basically implemented using three components. And the first component that we're going to discuss is SE Linux in the Linux kernel. So SE Linux is basically implemented, or is basically a LSM based SE Linux security framework. It's basically implemented as a Linux security module. So Linux security modules is a mechanism that was designed or when SE Linux was submitted for inclusion in the Linux kernel. Basically, what Linux security modules allows is to not favor one optional security system like SE Linux over another. Basically, the idea was, okay, we have SE Linux, but other people might want to implement other optional security systems. So how can we deal with that? How can we allow people to use another security optional security system rather than SE Linux? And that's basically the challenge that Linux Security Modules tries to address. It gives the end users, the owners, discretion over which optional security system to use. So, Linux Security Modules, a way to implement an optional security system. And the way that works is that basically you build the kernel and you can set the config default security option and set that to your optional security system. So in this case you use quote SE Linux unquote, and you can override that actually at that's on build time. The first the config default security is a build time tunable or conditional, I guess. But you can also do that on runtime by specifying the security kernel boot parameter and set that to the SE Linux optional security system name. That allows you to basically override the build time option at runtime using the security kernel boot parameter. So that's basically the core component of SE Linux, SE Linux in the kernel. So let's look a little bit deeper at SE Linux in the kernel, because basically SE Linux in the Linux kernel is basically has three elements. The SE Linux architecture has three elements. So let's just briefly touch on these three elements. So the main element is called what is called a security server. So that security server maintains security context, and it's also another term that you need to keep in the back of your mind. It maintains security context and computes access decisions. And provides security policy decisions to what's called object managers, permitting object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used. Now, I don't expect you to understand the second part of this sentence, but suffice to say that SE Linux allows user space to implement object managers that act as a extension to SE Linux in the user space on the on an application layer. So you can basically implement access control on the application layer by using a SE Linux extension. So there are various user space object managers available. So by basically decoupling the policy decisions from the object managers, we enable the implementation of object managers on an application layer or in the user space. So, but we'll get into object managers later, or at least the kernel object manager. So the second element is an access vector cache. Basically, it stores access decision computations provided by the security server for subsequent use by object managers. So basically it is a cache that can be hit for subsequent access decision computations, I guess. And it just should speed up things and it should save resources, and that's basically the main the goal of caches in general. So it's basically an access vector cache. The last element is what's called a kernel object manager. So it's an object manager of the kernel. It's the kernel object manager. So we just briefly touched on object managers in general, and now let's get into the kernel object manager, which is basically just an object manager for kernel objects. So it manages a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those kernel resources. And policy decisions are obtained from the security server, as we touched on when we discussed the security server, where we discussed provide security policy decisions to object managers. So here we touch on that again. So it manages a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those kernel resources. So that's specific to the kernel object manager. And other object managers might manage sets of other resources and enforce policy decisions over those other resources. So let's have a brief example. We have, for example, the dbus implements a object manager. So the dbus object manager manages a set of dbus resources and enforces policy decisions over those dbus resources. And there might be other object managers, for example, database object managers, where a database object manager manages a set of database resources and enforces policy decisions over those database resources. Sorry about that. That's confusing. So basically, the fact that the security server provides security decisions to object managers, permitting object managers to remain independent of specific security policy that is used, allows for object managers to be implemented in the user space rather than only in the kernel. So it allows that aspect allows you to extend as Linux to the user space, which is done now. And I touched on the databases, SE, PostgreSQL. I touched on dbus, but currently systemd also has an extension to SE Linux to enforce access control on the systemd application layer, and there are other examples as well. For example, Xserver. So those are the three elements of the SE Linux architecture. And this was just a brief overview. I don't expect you to actually understand all the technical details, although they are available on the internet. So if you go to the nsa.gov/research/SE Linux site, you'll find plenty documentation about technical details of all this stuff, and you are encouraged at some point to when you're ready for it, to actually read it and try to put the pieces together. So when SE Linux basically is enabled and started on the system, then a security sudo file system is mounted traditionally under /SE Linux, but more recently you'll find it under /sys/fs/SE Linux. And that sudo file system basically provides an interface to SE Linux. It provides us with a way to talk, or it provides the user space with a way to talk to SE Linux. So identify SE Linux, the second component is the SE Linux user space component. And this component basically provides tools and libraries that complement SE Linux in the Linux kernel. So that first component that we just discussed. Tools that you need to actually be able to work with the other components, so to speak. So this component is basically divided into a few elements. I will basically have a broad overview of those elements with a broad description. And the elements that are important to us, we'll discuss them later in the book or in the presentation. And other elements that we don't discuss, it's up to you to basically explore those and to basically find those, identify those. And they are actually, there's a website at www.oss.tresses.com/projects/ I think it is user space, that basically has a list of all the different tools and libraries that make the as a Linux user space component. Anyway, so the first main element is the are the policy compilation tools. So policy compilation tools allow you to perform the conversion of the text-based SE Linux policy language into the format used by the kernel for enforcement. So text-based SE Linux policy language, we'll get into that in the next presentation, because that's also an important aspect of SE Linux, because it teaches you, or it allows you to talk to SE Linux using the SE Linux policy language. And the policy compilation tools enable the perform the conversion of text-based SE Linux policy language to the format used by the kernel. So from text-based to binary-based, to binary. The second aspect is policy management tools, which allow you to install, remove, and update SE Linux policies on running systems. And we'll get into these tools, too many, if not all of these tools, later on. Then we have policy development tools. Those are tools that aid in the creation and updating of policy. We'll also probably touch on most of those later on. And the other tools, or the ones that we don't touch on, you can find them on the URL that I just mentioned, or use your favorite search engine to find it. It's all on the internet. The goal of this presentation is to basically guide you, basically provide you with bullet points of the important waypoints that you should use to basically tie it all together, because there's so much information. I can't possibly discuss everything. I'm just cherry picking the important points that you should probably just follow to get to your interpretation of what SE Linux is and how it is used and why it's good. So the fourth component, I guess, are the libraries, the SE Linux libraries. So those are libraries for applications that must be aware of SE Linux or enforce access control decisions using SE Linux. So we, in the previous slide, we explained that object managers enforce access control decisions using SE Linux. And so the SE Linux libraries can be used to basically implement that on a application, or implement a object user space object manager, so to speak, user application object manager. And other than that, and we'll get into that later in detail, applications can be SE Linux aware. They can even have some discretion over SE Linux security aspects, but we'll get into that later. Just for now, suffice to say that SE Linux is a mandatory access control system that allows you to govern security centralized. So the last aspects are the utilities, which are used for working with and administration of SE Linux enabled systems. We'll get into those, or many of those as well, later on in the second presentation. And then the last component of the three components is the SE Linux policy component. Policy is just basically configuration data. So it's basically, so that's why it's located under /etc/SE Linux, because that's where configuration data usually goes. And that's basically all we have to, I want to mention about Azure Linux policy right now, because this book is about Azure Linux policy administration. So we'll get into the nitty gritty, to the ugly details later. Suffice to say that Azure Linux policy configuration is located under ECS in Linux. So this is a important part of this presentation, and it's called Azure Linux security models. So Azure Linux security models are models that Azure Linux can use to address common challenges. So what we previously discussed some of the challenges that Azure Linux tries to address. For example, it tries to complement identity-based access control. It tries to enforce integrity, fine-grained mandatory access control. And it optionally provides a way to enforce confidentiality, and provides a way to enforce compartmentalization, isolation, / separation. So those are basically four broad challenges that Azure Linux security models use to address those challenges. There are currently six common security models. So there are six different models to address common challenges, and we basically highlighted four main challenges. But for example, the some of these challenges, like for example to enforce integrity, can have sub challenges. That's why there are six security models for the four challenges, common challenges, that we discussed above. So there are three default security models and three optional security models. And that's important to understand, that you don't have to, that Azure Linux doesn't implement all six security models by default, just three, and that three security models are optional. And those three basically pertain to the confidentiality enforcement and compartmentalization enforcement, which is optional. But we'll get into that later. So again, security models address particular challenges. So another thing of note is that the flexible configurable and open nature of Azure Linux allows for the design and implementation of additional security models. So if you have some exotic challenge that you want to use Azure Linux to address, then you could basically design your own Azure Linux security model and use that to address that challenge. Now, in practice, that's pretty unlikely. I can't think of any of those challenges that you might want to address using Azure Linux security models, but it's possible due to the flexible, configurable, and open nature of Azure Linux. So, important to know that it really isn't fixed. You can basically implement your own security models. So let's just look at each of those common security models in a bit more detail. So the first default security model is the Identity-Based Access Control Security Model, abbreviated IBAC. And this is basically a special security model, because it's special because it's basically a security model that glues Azure Linux to the traditional identity-based discretionary access control security framework. So it's basically a bridge between traditional Linux security and Azure Linux. It's basically a security model that deals with how Azure Linux complements traditional Linux security. And basically, the identity-based access control security model uses what's called identity security identifiers, or a concept of and we spoke about the concept of security identifiers, which can be basically declared, created by us and assigned by us to subjects and objects. Well, IBAC uses those identifiers to glue as Linux to traditional Linux security. So this is kind of important, and I have a slide that basically explains it at the end of the session, that basically tries to put those pieces together, because this is a little bit complex. Basically, what IBAC does is associate IBAC identity security identifiers to the user identity security identifiers and group identity security identifiers provided by traditional Linux security. So it's a association between the SL Linux identity identifiers and the traditional Linux identity identifiers, so to speak. Additionally, IBAC associates those identity security identifiers to role security identifiers provided by the role-based access control security model, which we're about to discuss in the next slides. And the same, IBAC uses identity security identifiers to optionally associate MLS, multi-level security, security sensitivity security identifiers. And the same goes for identity security identifiers get associated to MCS multi-category security, category security identifiers. So it's basically a bridge between traditional Linux security and other SE Linux security models. It's a glue security model, so to speak. And then there are ways to allows you to determine whether an IBAC identity security identifier can change using additional policy constraints, which we'll get in later, and using access factors, which are basically the core of SE Linux policy enforcement, security enforcement, provided by the object managers. So access factors are actually provided by object managers, because access factors are basically combinations of resources and ways to access it, and that's basically actually what object managers manage. They manage access to resources, and that's basically what access factors are. They are ways of accessing particular resources, and the combination of a resource and a set of ways of how one would be able to access that is what's called an access factor. So identity-based access control build a bridge between traditional Linux security and SE Linux, achieves SE Linux complementing of traditional Linux security, one of those big goals that SE Linux tries to address. It wants to complement traditional Linux security rather than be a independent security system. The second default access control security model is called role-based access control security model, or abbreviated RBAC. So RBAC, the challenge that RBAC tries to address, aims to address, is it allows us, the administrators, to govern access to one or more TE type security identifiers. And we haven't discussed the TE access control security model yet, but suffice to say that role-based access control enables us to govern access to one or more of those type enforcement access control security models, type security identifiers, using the role-based access control role security identifier. So basically it enables us to associate types and roles, or type security identifiers and role security identifiers. Create associations between the two. Anyways, we'll get into that later. And it also allows us to associate role security identifiers to identity-based access control identity security identifiers. And here again, we discuss that it allows us to associate role security identifiers provided by role-based access control to type security identifiers provided by type enforcement access control security model. And then it enables us to determine whether role security identifiers can change or transition automatically, change manually, or transition automatically if the above prerequisites are met. So if the associations are in place. We'll get into this later. This is a little much because it's all associated. And as Linux is all about association, grouping, and labeling. So the third default access control security model is called the Type Enforcement Access Control Security Model, abbreviated TE. And we touched on that term already in previous slides. So the challenge to address TE type enforcement is basically the core security model of Azure Linux. So access factors are basically the core security attributes of Azure Linux, and type enforcement is basically the core access control security model. So the challenge to address is to enforce integrity of subjects by assigning type enforcement type security identifiers to subjects and objects to process these in system resources and govern how subjects can interact with or operate on subjects or objects respectively by using access factors provided by object managers and the type security identifiers. So additionally, it allows us to determine whether type security identifiers can manually change or transition if the IBAC and RBAC prerequisites are met, because these associations must be there for this manually changing or automatically transitioning to be allowed or be specified. So this is the core security model of Azure Linux. Type enforcement and access factors, core. And then we're going on, we'll proceed with the optional security models. So those are optional, and they are basically add another layer of quote constraints, unquote, that can be used to override the some aspects of the default security models. They are an optional add-on. They allow additional restrictions / constraints. So let's discuss the optional user-based access control security model, abbreviated UBAC. So UBAC basically allows us to optionally compartmentalize or isolate or separate specified subjects using UBAC identity security identifiers. So basically the optional user-based access control security model also uses the identity security identifiers, just like IBAC does, the identity-based access control. So they both use the same identifiers, but they both use them in a different way. IBAC uses it to create associations between traditional Linux security and other security models, and UBAC uses the identity security identifier to isolate processes that otherwise have the same properties. Using additional policy constraints. So again, we'll get into policy constraints later, but just note that they're the additional. So it's an add-on. It adds additional constraints to the default quote constraints unquote that the default security models basically use, and access factors provided by object managers. Yeah, so it also, so you can see those access factors are used by many different security models, and so they're basically a core component. So that user-based access control allows you to basically separate users. That's basically what it is. Because I'm using those fancy terms, I want you to be familiar with the proper terms. But basically, it's just, it allows you to separate, isolate specified users. Additionally, in addition to the other default security models. So the second optional security model is the optional multi-level access control security model, abbreviated MLS. So what this does is it basically allows you to optionally enforce confidentiality and additionally compartmentalization or isolation separation. So it allows you to actually control the flow of information in shared computer systems. Enforce confidentiality using subjects of subjects by assigning or associating one or more MLS sensitivity security identifier to subjects and objects, and enforce quote no read up and no write down. So let's say you have two sensitivity security identifiers, 0 and 1, and there's a hierarchy between those sensitivities where it says, okay, 0 is the lowest sensitivity and 1 is the highest sensitivity. Then those sensitivities are assigned to processes and files, and then there's this rule that says no read up and no write down. So a process with a lower with the lower sensitivity of 0 cannot read files of created by of files that are labeled with the sensitivity of 1, and processes with sensitivity of 1 cannot write to files or processes with the lower sensitivity of 0. So that's basically how MCS or MLS allows you to enforce the flow or control the flow of information in shared computer systems. And it uses IBAC to basically associate those that allow us to associate those sensitivities to users or user the traditional Linux security user identity identifiers. We'll get into that later. We'll, at the end of this slide, we'll have a look at how that all fits in. So additionally, it allows us to enforce compartmentalization. So we can also isolate processes that might otherwise operate on the same with the same sensitivity. We can also compartmentalize it, those, or isolate those. So for example, you could have processes on top secret with top secret sensitivity, but then divided in, for example, top secret homeland and top secret foreign, and then processes that might have the sensitivity of top secret could be isolated to just homeland or to just foreign. So that's what compartmentalization, in addition to confidentiality, does. Basically, enforce compartmentalization of subjects by assigning one or associating one or more MLS category security identifier. So it's using categories to subjects and objects, using additional policy constraints again. So important to understand that the additional part, it's an add-on. And access vectors, again, here we have it again, the core access vectors provided by object managers. And it allows us to determine whether MLS sensitivity security identifiers and MLS category security identifiers can manually change or automatically transition if identity-based access control and type enforcement prerequisites are met. So IBAC must be used to basically associate categories and sensitivities to user identities. If those categories aren't associated, then those sensitivities and categories cannot change because they don't have access to them. And TE is a prerequisite because automatic transitions happen on executing files, and files access to files is enforced using type enforcement. And so you must be able from a type enforcement perspective to execute a file to be able to automatically transition from one category or sensitivity to another. So those prerequisites must be met before that automatic transition or manually change can happen in the first place. So the MLS and MCS security models are mutually exclusive because they interpret the security level security attribute in different ways. We'll get into what a security level security attribute is later on, but suffice to say that the MCS security model that we're about to discuss, I get, we haven't discussed that, so that's the last optional security model that we're going to discuss, is basically, and the MLS security model which we discuss in this slide are basically mutually exclusive because they use the same what's called a security attribute, but they interpret that security attribute in a different way. So you can't actually have the MCS security model and the MLS security model enabled at the same time, because that conflicts, because they use the same information but they interpret that information in a different way. So that's MLS, enforcement of confidentiality and isolation, separation, compartmentalization using additional policy constraints and the access vectors provided by object managers. And again, optional, additional. So the last optional security model is the MCS security model, abbreviated MCS, and multi-category access control security model. Basically, this just allows for part of what MCS does, the compartmentalization part only. So this security model doesn't control the flow of information in shared computer systems, but it does allow for compartmentalization based on the category security identifiers. Compartmentalization, isolation, separation based on category security and the identifiers. So let's just read it up. Enforce compartmentalization of specified subjects. So also, rather than MLS, where MLS basically enforce compartmentalization on every subject, MCS enables compartmentalization of specified subjects. So you can basically specify the processes on which to enforce compartmentalization, so you don't have to enforce it on all the processes, by assigning one or more or associating one or more MCS category security to subjects and objects using additional policy constraints and access vectors provided by object managers. So basically, that's basically the difference between how MLS uses compartments or categories and how MCS uses compartments or categories. Basically, in MCS, it's basically MCS allows you to only enforce it for specified subjects, where MLS basically enforces it on all subjects. And basically, the sensitivity part that I discussed, the sensitivity security identifier, in combination with a category security identifier, makes up a single security attribute called a sensitivity, a security level. And that security level is also used, that security level, security attribute is also used by MCS, but MCS only uses the category part of that combination. We'll get into that later, but we'll get into that later when we talk about what's called security context. But that's why they're mutually exclusive. They use the same security attribute, but MCS only uses one part of that security attribute and interprets that in a different way. So you can't use them both at the same time. So with this information, because this is a lot of information, let's have a look at a slide. I created one slide here somewhere. I haven't created a slide. I'm going to create that slide. So let's just take a little bit of time. So on top of the stack, you have traditional Linux security. This is basically the base, traditional Linux security. And then basically, we use identity-based access control. To associate those two, create that bridge, that connection, that association, and then we use this IBAC again to create other associations between IBAC. So build a bridge between IBAC, other security models, and traditional security. IBAC is the bridge between traditional security and other security models. So let's just role-based access control. Role-based access control. So again, a bridge. So IBAC is a bridge between role-based access control and traditional Linux security. And so, optionally, IBAC can also be a bridge between multi, and I'll just create that in red, hopefully. Yeah, multi-level security. So optionally, IBAC also is a bridge between multi-level security access control. Oops. And optionally, or basically optionally, multi. Oh, I know. And I'll just use the different color, milk. And I'll choose. Actually, I'll just use red. Multi. Category. Security. Access. Control. And then let's just draw the bridge. So basically, optionally draws creates is a bridge. IBAC is optionally bridge between multi-level security or multi-category security and traditional Linux security, because multi-category security and multi-level security are mutually exclusive and are both optional. But by default, it creates a bridge between role-based access control and traditional Linux security. Now, role-based access control is also a access control model that basically accesses a bridge. And we'll go and we'll discuss that, which is basically type and force and access control. Basically, role-based access control is basically a way for us, for administrators, to govern access to type identifiers to users. That's basically, in a nutshell, what it allows. And those types basically are used, those type identifiers, the type enforcement security attributes, are used to basically enforce integrity. Role-based access control basically is a bridge between identity-based access control and type enforcement access control, and identity-based access control is basically a bridge between role-based access control and traditional Linux security. So once you understand this graph, you should be able to have get a grasp of at least the core, how all these default and optional security models are associated, and we also understand which challenges they address. This is basically the challenge of identity-based access control, is basically to build that bridge between traditional, to glue SE Linux in general to traditional Linux security. Role-based access control, the challenge of role-based access control is basically to allow us to govern access to type enforcement, type security identifiers to users, and multi-level security allows us to enforce confidentiality or the flow, control flow of the flow of information in shared computer systems, and to additionally compartment, enforce compartment. And the multi-category security access control only does compartmentalization using the same attributes that multi-level security uses for compartmentalization, but MCS and multi-level security basically both interpret them in different ways. So yeah, that's basically the drawing for now. So let's go on to the next topic, which is SE Linux is a labeling system. I briefly mentioned the three things that are important to SE Linux, which is basically associating, grouping, and labeling. Now this chapter is all about labeling. Labeling is basically the most important thing to, or for one of the most important things to SE Linux, because SE Linux basically labels subjects and objects with security metadata. We'll call those security contexts, and we'll get into security contexts a little later. Just know that SE Linux labels processes and system resources with security contexts, and security contexts are basically security metadata. So access decisions are computed using those security contexts. So that security metadata that is basically assigned to processes and system resources is basically used by SE Linux to calculate whether some access, some requested access should be permitted or denied. So it's important that you ensure that those labels are correct, because these those labels, those security contexts basically classify these processes and system resources. These labels carry the security metadata, so the security metadata must be correct to be able to enforce the correct access. So it's important to always ensure that those labels are correct, and if there are issues, the first thing you should check is the labeling correct? Because if the labeling isn't correct, then everything else is irrelevant, because that's the core. If first labeling must be correct. So with that said, let's have a look at the SELinux security context. So SELinux security contexts are basically labels with security metadata, SELinux security metadata, that are assigned or associated to processes and system resources by SELinux. So security contexts are strings with security attributes delimited by columns. Each security attribute associates to one or more security models. Security contexts have a minimum of 3 security attributes and a maximum of 4 security attributes. Security attributes enable us to assign security identifiers to objects. So let's draw this into our graph. So let's just first explain that security context. And so let's go back. So security contexts are strings with security attributes delimited by columns. Each security attribute associates to one or more security models. So let's just draw this out. Oops. So let's draw a security context in essence. So it's a string delimited by columns. Those are columns. It's hard to see, but those are columns. So, and between those columns are fields. Those fields are called security attributes. Each security attribute associated to a security model. So the first field in a security context, the first security attribute associates to the identity-based access control model by default. And I'll call this an identity security attribute, because that's what it is. The field is actually a security attribute. And the identity security, actually we haven't touched on UBAC in this regard, but UBAC also uses the identity security attribute. The second field is the role security attribute, which associates to role-based access control. The third field is the type security attribute, associates to type enforcement, and the last security attribute is a security level security attribute. We briefly touched on that. So this is basically a security context from a global perspective. It's basically a string delimited by columns with security attributes that map to security models. So let's create that mapping. Let's create those associations. So the identity security attribute is associated to identity-based access control. The role security attribute is associated to role-based access control. The type security attribute is associated to type enforcement. Oops. And the multi-level security, security level attribute are associated to both multi-category security access control and multi-level security access control. They both, those two access control models both use that same security attribute, but in different ways. So let's just create those associations just to visualize it. So that's basically a visual representation of the associations of how the access control models associate to fields in security attributes, and in a security context. And a security attribute is basically a name of the field in a security context. So now next, here is another important concept that it touches on. Here also, let me explain this. Security contexts have a minimum of 3 security attributes and a maximum of 4 security attributes. So we know that these two access control models are optional. So if they are not used, then this security attribute is not needed. And thus, your security context has only 3 fields. So if either one of those is enabled, then your security context will have a second field. And if those two aren't enabled, then you'll only have 3 fields because this security attribute is only used for these two optional security models. Okay, so that with that out of the way, let's go on to the final. So security attributes enable us to assign security identifiers to processes and an object. So security contexts are basically assigned to subjects and objects, to processes and system resources. And security attributes enable us to assign security identifiers. So let's see how we're going to visualize that. Well, just write that in. Identity security. Identifier. And let's just make this green. And also, let's just, for the sake of completeness, I guess, touch on the identifiers of traditional Linux security. So, and this should be green. User group identity security identifiers. So traditional Linux security uses user and group identity security identifiers, so UIDs, GIDs, identity based access control uses identity, security identifier, and all role-based access control uses or allows us to assign role security identifier and type enforcement allows us to declare and associate type security identifiers and multi-level security. Sensitivity and category security identifier, whereas multi-level security category security identifier. So basically, this is the whole picture of how it all associates. So the fields themselves are security attributes, but they are filled in with respective identifiers that are created by us, the administrators, and we assign them to the attributes, and each of these attributes associate to an access control model. So it allows us, the combination allows us to first make a association between SE Linux and traditional Linux, then basically allows us to associate type identifiers to traditional Linux users using role security identifiers. Then it's the type security identifier associated type security attribute maps to the type enforcement security model, which allows us to enforce least privilege, enforce integrity on processes and system resources. Basically, we're labeling those processes and files with type identifiers, and then we're defining how a type identifier can operate on or interact with other type identifiers. And then the sensitivity and category security identifier that we can create that we can create courtesy of the multi-level security access control are basically associated to the security level, and that allows us to enforce confidentiality and compartmentalization, whereas the category security identifier only provides for the compartmentalization. And let's just also fill in IBAC, because IBAC is a special case, I guess. Oops, let's just put that. User-based access control, let's make that association. It's a different association because that same security attribute is just used for a different security model additionally. And we're using the same identity identifiers that we can't. Identity security identifier. Yeah, so this is basically drawn. And this basically allows compartmentalization based on the identity security identifier. So this basically is the drawing. This is basically the graphic representation of how all these associations work. So we have security models, we have security attributes, and we have security identifiers. And those associate, those are giving us this that configurability and the ways to address challenges, particular challenges like creating that association between traditional Linux security and SE Linux, and enforcing integrity, and enforcing confidentiality optionally, and enforcing compartmentalization optionally, whether it's compartmentalization by using the category security attribute or the identity security attribute. And it allows us to basically govern access of users to type identifiers using the role-based access control model. So that's about six different challenges there, I guess. So yeah, this is a nice graph, I think, so that should basically make that a little bit clear. So that's, yeah, and here we're getting into all these details, so let's just go over this again. So here we have that string again, identity role type security level. Those are the attributes delimited by colons. The first security attribute in the security context is called a identity security attribute, and that's in the graph as well, and associates to the IBAC security model, and optionally to the UBAC security model. So here we have it, first string in the security context, associates to IBAC security model, and optionally, so I should make this actually green, actually red. Because red is optional. Undo. And then type. And then make it red. To just signal that it's optional. I should make a legend red optional and additional. Anyway, so that's what that does. The identity security attribute can be used to assign identity security identifiers to processes and system resources, subjects and objects. So that's where the identity security identifier comes in here. Alright, second security attribute in a security context is a role security attribute and associates to the role-based access control security model. The role security attribute can be used to assign role security identifiers to processes and system resources, to subjects and objects. So let's just go over that. The second security attribute associates the role-based access control and allows us to assign role security identifiers to processes and system resources. Due to the challenge that role-based access control addresses, role security identifiers are only used for subjects. So SE Linux basically uses these security contexts to associate security metadata to files and or to processes and system resources. But system resources other than processes don't use the role security attribute, or they don't use role security identifiers, because role-based access control is basically a way to assign access to govern access to types to govern access of types users to access of to access. All right, let's try this again. Role-based access control is used to govern the access of users to type security identifiers. So it isn't used for files on files. So what role-based access control is not used for files. So thereby the object underscore r role security identifier, which is actually an initial security identifier, which we'll discuss later, is assigned to the role security attribute in a security context of a of file object. So if you're looking at a file or another object, then you'll see that the role security attribute is filled in with the object underscore r quote initial unquote role security identifier. So just remember that role-based access control is only used for processes, because it's basically a way to govern access of users to type security identifiers, and users are processes, not files. So that's basically a quick note about that. So the role security attribute in security context of objects is filled in with the object underscore r role identifier, which is initial security identifier, which we'll discuss later, which basically functions as a placeholder. So that's basically a placeholder, because that field is there in the security context. It's always there, the second field, but it doesn't apply to files or to objects. So it's just filled in with the object underscore r roles initial security identifier, just to hold that place, just to fill in that space. But it doesn't mean anything. Okay, the third security attribute in the security context is a type security attribute and associates to the TE security model, type enforcement security model. The type security attribute can be used to assign type security identifiers to processes and system resources. So the third type security attribute associates to type enforcement access control and can be used to assign type security identifiers by administrators to processes and files, because this one is assigned. And I should make that association as well. Let's just do that. Processes and I should make this a different color, just to processes and system resources, and then below there I'll just subjects. And objects. Just I'm trying to make it as clear as possible, because this is the fundamentals of SE Linux. And then just create that association. So the security contexts are assigned to processes and system resources, and then these are the associations. So yeah, that's basically that. So the type security attribute can be used to assign type security identifiers to objects and to subjects and objects. So that's basically we discussed this. I think third field type security attribute. Used for type enforcement access control allows us to assign type security identifiers to processes and system resources. Boom. Alright. And then the fourth field. The optional fourth security attribute, which is optional, so I should make that optional. I'll make that red. Security level, security attribute. And damn, that's not going to work. So let's just do that different. So we just want to make it clear that the fourth field is an optional field. All right. Or the fourth security attribute is an optional security attribute. So optional fourth security attribute in security context is a security level security attribute and associates to the MLS and MCS security models. We did that. So this one associates to both these two and the two optional security models. Associates to the optional MLS and optional MCS security models. The security level security attribute can be used to assign sensitivity and category security and identifiers and ranges of sensitivity and category security identifiers to subjects and objects. Now we haven't really dealt with that, but you can assign ranges of categories rather than a single category. So you could be compartmentalized using different categories. For example, if you look at, for example, colors, you could be compartmentalized to green and to yellow and to red, or combinations thereof, of ranges thereof. And that's as far as I go with regard to that for now. So the security level attribute can be used to assign sensitivities and categories or ranges of categories to subjects and objects. Due to the challenge that the multi-category access control model addresses, sensitivity security identifiers are not used in the MCS security model. So, and it's already described here, the MLS security model uses both the sensitivity and category security identifier, which is basically combined into the single security level attribute. This is kind of weird because you have basically two identifiers combined into a single security attribute, where in the other three we have single security identifiers. So there's no combination of security identifiers in a single security attribute, but this one is different. So the multi-level security uses both the sensitivity and category security identifiers, whereas the multi-category security access control model only uses the category. So the sensitivity security identifier is filled in with a placeholder, just like the role security identifier is filled in with the object underscore R role for objects rather than subjects. The sensitivity security identifier is filled in with a default low sensitivity in multi-level security, because multi-level security doesn't enforce integrity, so that attributes that is used, or that, yeah, that security identifier that is used for enforcing integrity is not used for multi-category security. So it's there, but it's unused. So that's why it's always set to system low or S0, the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy, so to speak. And in MLS, there is just a single sensitivity, which is the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy, because the sensitivities aren't enforced. So that's just one thing to keep in mind, that although a MCS system might have a full security level security attribute, which is a combination of a sensitivity and a category and categories. The sensitivity isn't actually used and is just a placeholder, or and that's S0, the lowest sensitivity. Hope that explains that. The sensitivity security is filled in with, oh, let's just, yeah. The sensitivity security attribute in security context on systems with the MCS security model enabled is filled with the S0 sensitivity security identifier. And S0 is basically the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy, which functions as a placeholder. The security level security attribute is also delimited by, oh yeah, this is another that I touched on there as well already as well. So the security level security attribute is also delimited by a column, but the combination of a sensitivity security identifier and category security identifier, or ranges of category security identifiers, are a single security attribute. So that's just weird. So let's just